Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the New York Society for Ethical Culture. This is the first in a series on the ethics of the philosophy of ethics, which is going to continue on through March.
Right.
So we're going to make, remember, if you remember, Wednesday being Prince Spaghetti Day. Well, this is going to be Thursday is Philosophy Night. And Joe will be doing the inaugural sessions, three sessions on the philosophy of ethics. After that, we're going to have Arthur Dobrin, who is an emeritus leader at the Long Island Society, and he's going to speak about the art of happiness based on his book, The Art of Happiness, and he'll be following the book, so you may want to actually acquire a copy to go along. That'll be four sessions. After him is going to be Professor David Sprinson from the Long Island Society, a retired philosophy professor and an expert really on existentialism. And he's going to speak about existentialism, Camus, and also John Dewey. After him, another longtime ethical culture participant, Dr. Joe Palau, a philosophy professor as well, and a really interesting guy, is going to be talking about non-Western streams of philosophy of ethics. And that there'll be some for South Asia and some for East Asia. So that promises to be really interesting. That will be in February and March. So keep Thursday nights open because this is going to be really a wonderful series. So the first one is Joe, the one with the headphones on.
Right.
He is a longtime leader in the ethical culture movement and a leader at the New York Society for Ethical Culture. He's been a professor of humanities, human rights, and philosophy at Columbia University, at Hunter College, and other institutions, too numerous to mention, although he'll probably want to name them all. So I just invite you all to listen to Joe Chuman. Now, I just ask everybody to mute themselves, that way we won't have stray noises coming through. We have a nice group tonight, almost 30 people, and maybe some others will trickle in. So to best manage it, let's try to keep ourselves muted, and we're going to feature Joe now. Okay, Joe, take it away.
Okay. Thanks very much, Richard. I see this is an important event. We're talking about ethics in ethical culture. And my hope is that we can enrich your knowledge about ethics, and by so doing, enrich ethical culture itself by reaffirming ethics as being central to what we're about. But in order to talk about ethics, I think it's important that people gain a deeper understanding. And in this case, we're going to be somewhat technical. Okay, that's not a bad word for me. Somewhat technical in terms of going into what ethics is philosophically. And that really is a mainstay of the course. But the objectives are practical. We want to enrich and thicken the climate and culture of ethical culture societies, especially the New York Society, out of which this program originates. So it does have a practical purpose. As Richard said, I've long been an academic. I just recently retired from both Hunter and Columbia, but I had taught previously, I taught philosophy and ethics at William Paterson College, at Fairleigh Dickinson University. I taught ethics at the Macaulay Honors College, at Hunter College for a good number of years. And then I shifted primarily to my work at Columbia for the last 20 years, where I taught human rights in the graduate school, which has a type of ethical, by implication, ethical component, but it's not ethics per se. I also taught human rights under the aegis of the United Nations at its university in Costa Rica. And one of my earlier teaching assignments, which really helped to format my intellectual life, was way back when I was scratching out my doctorate, I taught for several years, taught contemporary civilization or the history of Western ideas at Columbia University. So I've had a lot of conversance with these notions. I've long read in philosophy and so on and so forth, as well as have taught ethics specifically. So here we are. Today is an introduction, considered Ethics 101. Okay, to the very basis of ethics. And what I'd like to do is do what I often do in the university, and that is lecture for a while, and then open it up to any questions or thoughts that you might have. First, what I'd like to do is just mention where ethics fits in the panoply of philosophical disciplines. Classically understood, there are five major branches of philosophy. There are other minor ones, but the five major branches are as follows. There is metaphysics, which is sometimes seen as the queen of all philosophical sciences. And metaphysics is basically a study of how reality is constituted, how reality is put together at the deepest level. So if you ask the question, is reality primarily material or is it primarily idea, okay, or spirit? That is a metaphysical question. Okay, how is reality constituted? Metaphysics. The second major branch of philosophy is logic, which is the study of the formal relations between principles. So if I put out the syllogism that all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore it must inevitably follow without exception that Socrates is mortal. Okay, it's a logical using the principles of logic to basically come to a understanding of truth. The third major branch of philosophy is epistemology. And epistemology is the study of how we know what we know and what constitutes knowledge. Interesting question. Do we know, and I would love to talk about this, but that's not the topic for tonight. The question is, do we know what we know through the use of our senses, our five senses? Do we know what we know through logical deduction, which does not use our senses? Do we know what we know through intuition or some other form of the acquisition of knowledge? How do we know what we know? Those are epistemological questions. The fourth branch of philosophy, which we will deal with, is ethics. Ethics is the study of right and wrong, good and bad, and what is the basis? It also asks the question, a somewhat different question, what is the basis for a good life? Okay. Ethics sometimes is used interchangeably with the word or term morality, but in a more technical sense, they're not exactly identical. Morality may pertain to the specific customs and mores of a particular people, okay? Whereas ethics is a branch of philosophy that attempts to deduce from moral behaviors universal principles of morality. That is, those principles that may be applicable to all people in all places, okay, crudely speaking. Such is ethics, right and wrong, good and bad, what constitutes the good life. And the fifth branch of ethics, the fifth branch of philosophy is aesthetics. Aesthetics, that is the study of beauty, okay? Is beauty merely in the eyes of the beholder and abjectly subjective? Or in effect, are there standards of beauty that inhere in the nature of reality, which all human beings can partake of? These are questions involving aesthetics. What makes something beautiful is a question that aesthetics would explore. So there you are. Those are the five major classical branches. They've been taught for over 2,000 years, going back to the Greeks, okay? The four major branches of philosophy. Again, metaphysics, the queen of the philosophical inquiries, logic, epistemology, ethics, and aesthetics. Today, we're going to be, and for the rest of this course, we're going to be dealing with ethics. Now, again, for a sort of fundamental introduction to ethics, there are three major schools or branches of ethics that have their own sub-branches or sub-schools, okay? The first, which I'll deal with tonight, is referred to as deontology. Don't get scared by the word, okay? Deontology. Deontology is comes from the Greek word deontos, which means duty, duty. And deontology primarily deals with ethics in such a way that it commits us to doing the right thing. Okay, deontology involves a duty to doing the right thing. Okay, deontology. The other major branch of which we'll talk about next week of philosophy is utilitarianism. Okay, utilitarianism is a major branch of what's known as consequentialism. In other words, it looks at the consequences of behaviors and actions in order to determine whether they are moral or not. Okay, and utilitarianism flourished in the late 18th and 19th century. There were two major figures, Jeremy Bentham, two Brits, Jeremy Bentham in the late 18th century, and one of the geniuses of the last 150 years, John Stuart Mill. Okay, was a father of utilitarianism, and the general rule of utilitarianism, and we'll talk about it next week, is that one's actions, if they are to be moral, are such that the consequences of those actions create greater pleasure over pain or happiness over unhappiness. In other words, you engage in an act and you try to measure what the consequences are and whether it leaves people, including everyone and counting every person as a single person, no one is privileged, whether the aggregate effect of one's behaviors leave people better off. Okay, that is crudely, broadly speaking, utilitarianism. The third branch of ethics, which is sort of much in vogue these days, doesn't deal with questions of right or wrong. It doesn't basically elaborate rules or of conduct or behavior. It's what's known as virtue ethics. And that has to do with those conditions that make for a life of flourishing. Okay, how can we create a flourishing environment for human beings? That's what virtue ethics does. It basically doesn't reduce itself to narrow rights and wrongs, but to the broader question of creating the conditions that adduce to human flourishing. So those are the three major branches or schools of ethics. Deontology, that deals with the question of doing what is right. Utilitarianism, which has to do with co the consequences of actions in such a way as to maximize happiness or well-being. And the third school of ethics is virtue ethics, and that involves creating the conditions or making the choices that will lead to a flourishing life. Okay, those are the three schools of ethics. What I wanted to talk about tonight is the first, and that is deontology. Now, one cannot, and this is important, let me just say, and I'll get to this at the end, of the three schools of ethics, let me see, I can't find the book, of the three schools of ethics, deontology clearly had the greatest influence on our founder of ethical culture, Dr. Felix Adler. And his thinking, in great measure, was inspired by probably the foremost luminary, philosophical luminary of the European Enlightenment, and that was the German thinker Immanuel Kant. Okay, an extremely important, brilliant, and extremely important thinker whose writing style is almost impenetrable. Okay, very, very difficult thinker. He wrote primarily on epistemology. He wrote three major critiques, which have been the bane of philosophy students, the critique of pure reason, the critique of practical reason, and the critique of judgment. Okay, he also wrote books on politics and the liberal state. In some ways, there's a part of Kant that resonates in our troubled times, would resonate today. He was also interested in creating what he called permanent peace, an international peace among nations. This goes all the way back to the 18th century, and so on and so forth. But he also wrote what is arguably the seminal, most important work on ethics. Okay. And it's unlike a lot of other of Kant's treatises, this book is shorter than most. It's less than 90 pages, and by comparison, is relatively accessible. Okay. It is not impenetrable. It's not easy for the layperson to get through. Obviously, extremely dry, but it is not totally abstruse, and it's something worth wrestling with. The book is called The Prologue to the Metaphysics of Morals, and it is probably the foremost, most powerful statement of deontological ethics that have been produced. And I just want to give you a very brief summary of Kant's Prologues to the Metaphysics of Morals that elaborates deontological ethics. Okay. Kant is a product, as I said, and a proponent of the Enlightenment that comes just after and aligns with the age of science. That was a period which was revolutionary in human thought, starting with Galileo in the early 17th century. It was discovered that human capacities could actually unlock, okay, the mysteries of the universe. During the Middle Ages, reality was mysterious. And in order to explain reality, it was basically requisitioned or handed over to divine explanation that was basically controlled by priests and church adepts. But very little was known about the outside world and so on and so forth. And lo and behold, in the 17th century, there was an extraordinary intellectual revolution. It was discovered that through reason and its application, human beings could actually push back the mystery, okay, of the universe and begin to understand how it functioned, and then later on was able to take that understanding through technology and apply it for the betterment of human society. The scientific revolution, an extraordinary breakthrough in terms of humanities, the career of humanity. The foremost exponent, there were many scientists, Galileo among the great ones, relatively early, but the acknowledged greatest scientist of that period was Sir Isaac Newton. Okay. And he was construed to be a freak of nature. I remember once reading a biography where the writer states that just as occasionally nature produces a two-headed dog or a three-legged goat, so the mind of Isaac Newton was a freak of nature. Okay. He deduced the laws of physics, how in effect the universe operates from the motions of the planets to the falling of acorns off of trees with regard to the laws of gravitation and other laws of, thermodynamics and other laws that dictate how indeed nature behaves. Until the time of Einstein, Newton basically was the foundation of scientific knowledge. He was construed to be the divine mind. This was, in other words, by reading the dispensations in physics of Isaac Newton, it was felt in that period that human beings could gain insight into the mind of God. Okay, this is what Newton had revealed. Sir Alexander Pope, who was a contemporary British poet, who wrote endless little rhyming couplets, it seems like his mind was formatted to write couplets, had an ode to Newton in which he said, "Nature and nature's laws lay hidden night, hid by night. God said, let Newton be, and all was light." Okay. In other words, analogizing Newton's insight to the Word of God. I mean, this was the power of Isaac Newton resting upon the traditions, the ongoing traditions of the scientific revolution. Newton said, however, and he was not a particularly nice man in his personal life, but there's a famous quote by Newton which indicates a certain degree of very refreshing modesty. He said, "The only reason I've been able to see a little further than other men is that I've stood on the shoulders of giants." That's a beautiful, absolutely beautiful metaphor. That was Newton. Now, why do I mention Newton? The reason I'm mentioning Newton is that Newton and the scientific revolution of the 17th and early 18th centuries really created the foundation and framework and inspiration for the philosophical enlightenment of many notable figures that came after that period, nonetheless, Immanuel Kant. Okay, why this long introduction? Because Kant, as an ethicist, says explicitly in the groundwork to the metaphysics of morals, he says explicitly, or almost explicitly, I'm basically paraphrasing him a little bit, where he says, I want to find in the world of morality a law that is as rock solid as Newton's laws are in the world of physics. Okay, that was his enterprise. And lo and behold, it's not a surprise, he engages in this intellectual exploration. And of course, he finds the law that he basically is looking for. And that law is come down in the history of ethics and philosophy. It's known as the categorical imperative, always written with capital letters, capital C, capital I, and very often abbreviated as CI, the categorical imperative. Well, what does that mean? Imperative means, of course, a command. If I issue you an imperative, I'm commanding you to do something. And categorical means in a category by itself. That is a standalone, off-the-shelf, absolute imperative. It is not dependent on anything else. It is self-standing, okay, in that regard. It is categorical. Now, Kant contrasts the categorical or categorical imperatives in principle, categorical imperatives with what he calls hypothetical imperatives. Hypothetical imperatives are those commands that you issue or receive if you want to have certain consequences to your actions. So if it starts with sort of the grammatically would work itself out to the structure, if this, then that. Okay. If you wish to gain a good job, then get an education. Okay. If you wish to be healthy, then eat right. Okay. If you wish to ensure a democratic, liberal democratic America, make sure you get out the vote. If this, then that. There are commands given. However, the categorical imperative is very different because there are no, again, conditions. It stands alone. Okay. Now, a second principle that is very important here is the principle of reason. Reason. For the Enlightenment, and especially for Immanuel Kant, reason was almost a magical oracle that dispensed its own truths. Okay. To get to Kant's appreciation of reason, we have to understand something about the way in which he believed the human being was constituted. Kant, as a German, came from a very strict Lutheran family. His parents were known as Pietists, which was a branch of Lutheranism that was very strict, very rigid, Achtung, very Prussian. Okay. He was a Pietist, and someone of a strong Christian legacy was endowed by the, or influenced by the dualism of Christianity. And what do I mean by dualism in this instance? That the human being is really made up of two substances. There is a physical body. We all have physical bodies, but then residing in the body is a spirit or a soul. And they are, from the strict Christian point of view, they are separate entities. So that when the body dies, the soul does not die. But if you've lived a virtuous life, you go upstairs and spend eternity with our Maker. Okay, that's dualism, and it is essential to Christian belief. Now, Kant did not philosophically totally accept dualism. He's not really a dualist, but it had an influence on him, and it had an influence on the way in which he elaborated his ethics. He believed that spirit or soul, of which reason was a major constituent, okay, had a type of freedom or autonomy from the body. Okay, what do I mean by that? Well, we clearly are creatures of senses. We're creatures of physical wants, needs, appetites. We experience bodily pleasure and pain. We're sensate creatures. But in addition to that, and within it, we're also creatures of reason. And Kant believed that our reason could be construed as independent of the determinants of our physical nature. Okay. Now, to some degree, we might accept this. So, for example, let me give you a crude, I'm jumping the gun a little bit to make just to illustrate what I'm trying to get across. Imagine, for example, you are physically very hungry. You haven't eaten in a long time and you're very hungry. Okay. You are walking down the street and you pass a fruit stand, and that apple is staring at you, and you have a physical emanated from your bodily nature. You have a physical impulse to reach out and grab that apple, okay, off the counter and steal it, eat it, and nourish yourself. Okay. But in the act of reaching your hand out, there's a little voice. Let's call it, for the sake of being right now, Kant would not have reduced it to this, but just to make the illustration clear, let's call it conscience, that reaches out, okay, and says, that is wrong. Stealing is wrong. And the conscience interferes with the physical sensate nature or appetite in such a way that it stills your impulse to steal that apple, okay? There's a certain freedom. Now, for Kant, morality or ethics is a very special mode, a unique mode of human behavior that resides in and is vested in this type of autonomy that indeed issues from our rational or reasoned capacity. Okay. Reason and morality, again, stand somewhat outside of our sensate, sensual natures in the way in which nothing else does, okay? It's an interesting precept. So where does this lead us? Kant basically says that as autonomous and free creatures, we can indeed promote or develop for ourselves, create for ourselves laws to which we choose to be obedient. That is what human beings' freedom entails, among other things. The capacity to frame laws that we then choose, our own laws of our own making, that we choose to obey. Now, how do we make our moral laws? How do we make our supreme moral law? How do we derive or come to the categorical imperative? Well, Kant says that indeed, one of the, for him, it has to be based, again, in the realm of freedom, okay, and reason, in the realm of freedom and reason. Now, one of the qualities of reason that was so attractive in the Enlightenment is that reason is universal. It's something that all people, okay, whether male, female, transgendered, white, black, European, Asian, Pacific Islander, all human beings, as human beings, this goes back to the Greeks, all human beings possess the quality of reason. It has a type of universal quality, okay? And Kant basically says that the supreme moral law, the categorical imperative, is derived from this universal capacity that reason entails, okay? And what he comes up with in the way in which he thinks reason works itself out is that he comes up with three instantiations or versions of the categorical imperative, okay, that he claims in the prologue are all basically reducible to the same thing, but he's not at all clear as to how they all add up to the same. But that question doesn't have to concern us. What are the three expressions of the categorical imperative? The first is, in effect, I did write this out. The first is and these come as commands, they're imperatives, is act in accordance with the maxim. He uses the word maxim a lot. A maxim, as he uses, is a subjective rule, your own subjective rule, okay? Act only in accordance with that maxim through which you can at the same time will that it become a universal law, okay? In other words, if you want to test the validity of your ethics, you have to take the rule that you're holding and universalize it. Another sort of not exactly accurate, but for the sake of our discussion, probably the easiest way to understand this is something that we very often do. We ask ourselves the question, when a friend of ours is engaging in an act that we think is morally dubious, we might challenge them by asking the question, what would happen if everybody did it? Okay, that's universalizing that rule. Now, if Kant says you can take your own private rule and universalize it without contradiction, okay, without contradiction, and that's an important principle, then indeed you have hit upon the categorical imperative. And he gives several examples of that, mostly negative ones, okay? So if you have for a rule for yourself, okay, that I will only repay a debt when I can afford to do it or when I feel like it, okay? Kant would maintain, if you take that rule, I will only repay a debt when I want to or when I can or I feel like it, and you universalize it, Kant will say that that will collapse. That rule cannot stand, okay? Simply because you can't live in a universe, right, where that rule is so readily violated, okay? So for him, that rule would not pass muster, which means that Kant comes down to the position, and this is hard for us to stomach, okay? Kant comes down to the position that the rules that the categorical imperative, that is those that are universalizable, require have to be absolute. That is, there is no exception. Now, let me just ratchet back a few steps and insert something that is very important to Kant's deontology. And that is that Kant is a rabid anti-consequentialist. If you want to know what's moral, never look at the consequences. Never look at the consequences. Okay. And he has reasons for that. He says, woe to the person who makes consequences the object of his ethical quest. Okay, he's an anti-consequentialist. The only thing, and I'll explain why a little bit further on, the only thing that matters to Kant, the only thing that can be moral is that the person has a good will. Okay, the only good thing in the universe, or out of it, Kant says, is a good will. And what he means by that is that our subjective will acts in accordance with the moral law, in obedience to it. But not only in accordance, he goes further than that. Our moral acts have to act from the moral law, and consequences are out of the picture. They may involve what Kant calls, and this is an interesting, when we think about ethics, an interesting contrast. Kant says, sure, he would approve of what we call prudential acts, but prudential acts are not, strictly speaking, ethical acts, because they may be based on a type of utilitarian mentality, on a concern for consequences, and do not indeed issue from the moral law. So for example, I'll give you a hokey example. If I go into my local hardware store and above the counter, there's a sign that says, honesty is the best policy. Okay, we might say, ah, that's moral. That's great. I have a moral hardware store owner. Kant would say, nah, honesty is the best policy is not an ethical dictum. Why? Because if indeed you are honest, okay, merely because it's the best policy or it will do you well or bring you in more customers, okay, you're acting, it may have a prudential cachet, but it's not ethical because you're doing it for the sake of self-interest. In other words, for Kant's ethics, there cannot be a smidgen of self-interest in your moral acts. But, you know, we can understand this to some degree, and I'll talk about a critique of Kant towards the end. We can understand this. I mean, if we have the multi-billionaire, let's take Mr. Sackler, okay, who donates millions of dollars to a local hospital in order to get his name on the cornerstone, okay, and enhance his reputation, and so on and so forth, we can ask, what's ethical about that? In other words, if you engage in an act simply because you're interested in a beneficent return, being it accruing more money, more wealth, or a greater reputation, so everybody says, gee, what a great generous guy Sackler is, we can ask ourselves the question, what's truly moral about that? It is that sensibility about the inadequacy of utilitarian or consequentialists' motives that Kant is absolutely decries. It has no place in his ethics. Again, he is an anti-consequentialist, anti-utilitarian. You have to act from the moral law. You have to express duty. And again, let me just repeat, in the first instantiation of the categorical imperative, the rule that you operate by has to be able to be universalized without contradiction. And it cannot be, in effect, a utilitarian reason. Now, let me ask, I'll just clarify a little bit, why is Kant so dead set on being an anti-utilitarian? And the reason is that, and here I'm sympathetic, especially in this age where we're so judgmental and harsh, Kant basically says, we as human beings can never predict the future. Okay, the only thing we can know is our own intentions. We cannot know what the consequences of our acts motivated by those intentions are. I may be walking on the beach on some windy day and I see a child 100 feet out drowning, okay? And I do my best. I risk my life to swim out there to save the child, and the child dies anyway. Okay, if I'm a strict consequentialist, I may be blamed for my action. But indeed, a Kantian, and I'm sympathetic to this, would look at it and say, look, the circumstances were such that the issues, the factors, the realities were bigger than I was, but don't judge me by the consequences, judge me by my purity of heart, judge me by my goodwill, judge me by my good intentions, judge me by my obedience to what I see is a higher moral imperative to basically rescue a child in need. Am I being clear about these differentiations? I'm trying to winnow out, okay, what the Kantian factor here is here. So the first, again, version of the categorical imperative is act only in accordance with that maxim through which you can at the same time will that it become a universal law. Making what Kant said would be a false promise. In other words, I make a promise to you, but I really don't intend to keep it. That cannot be universalized. Because imagine again if everybody did that. If they made promises which they didn't intend to keep, the whole idea, and Kant is such an intellectual rigorist, why that offends primarily to Kant is that the whole idea of promise keeping would lose its intellectual coherence and integrity. The word promise would have no meaning anymore if indeed people went around making what Kant calls false promises, okay, or intended to repay their debts only when they could. So Kant's, and this we have to recognize, is that Kant's ethics in some sense, and this is my interpretation, is in some sense impossible because it is absolute. It brooks no exceptions. But the value of Kant is he's saying something distinctive about ethics, which I think is important and worth contemplating and maybe even worth accepting, okay? That there is something about the ethical act that carries its own imperatives. Okay, now the second instantiation is the one that is really the most famous and I think is one of the most sublime dicta in the history of ethical thought. Okay, and this has a major influence on the creation of ethical culture. Felix Adler was primarily a Kantian, and although he critiqued Kant, his philosophy remained broadly Kantian throughout his career, and he, in effect, employed this dictum in the creation of ethical culture, and that spirit, I think, is still with the ethical movement. The second instantiation of the categorical imperative is, quote, as follows: act in such a way as to treat the humanity in others and oneself, in others and oneself, as an end and not merely as a means, end quote. That is one of the most brilliant, important, and I would say from the point of wisdom, one of the most brilliant and insightful dictums in the history of philosophical thought. And I'm naive enough to believe that if people lived according to the second instantiation of the categorical imperative, we've had a much better world. Let me go over that again and see what the implications are. He said, act in such a way as to treat the humanity in others and in oneself as an end and not merely as a means, which means that from Kant's point of view, there is a special, let me use a little fancy language here, sacred quality in every human being that differentiates the human being from any other aspect or creature in nature. And this may be clearly from his Christian inheritance. Let's call it humanity. Let's call it dignity, or whatever, that resides within the human person. And that reality dictates how we need to treat others and ourselves. And Kant says we treat them as an end in and of himself or herself, and not merely as a means. A synonym for a means would be a tool or an instrument, okay? And the reality is, if we look around how human beings behave, everything, okay, that we use as an instrumentality in order to augment our own gratification and satisfaction and well-being, whether it's our computer, our television set, or whether it be the ox that pulls our plow, we all use, let's use a harsher term, exploit things for our own benefit, okay? But Kant says there is one thing and one thing only in the universe that we may not treat for our own gratification, our own empowerment, our own interests, and that is the human person. We have to treat the person not as a tool to meet our needs, our impulses, our aggressions, our satisfactions, but we have to recognize the person's humanity, okay, and treat them as an end in and of themselves. And what he means by end, we can conclude, is creatures like us who are rational and autonomous, okay, who seek our own purposes. Now, the operative term in this, or an operative term in this little sentence, is the word merely. Kant recognizes that we're social creatures and we use each other all the time. When I teach a class at Columbia, my students are using me for their education. When I'm a leader in the ethical society, I'm being used for whatever ethical edification I can bring. We use each other all the time. When the truck driver brings food to the market, we're using it. We use people right and left. It's part of the social reality. Kant recognizes that. But if we reduce the person only to their utility, then indeed we are violating the categorical imperative. Now, when you look at this, this is, I think, a brilliant insight that tells us, in a negative sense, what types of behaviors are forbidden. It tells us very, almost explicitly, why slavery is morally wrong. Okay, that's the foremost, most dramatic example. When indeed we take a human being and we buy and sell him at auction, okay, we're turning him into merchandise, okay, to meet the needs of the purchaser, the slave owner, the master. We are basically removing the humanity of the human being and transforming them into nothing but a thing. Okay, that's a violation of the categorical imperative. When indeed, give you a somewhat lighter example, when the young woman protests with her boyfriend and says, you know, I'm really resenting your attitude towards my body. I'm not a
Joe, you lost your sound. Did you pull a plug?
How's that?
Yeah, you're back.
Yeah, sorry, must have come out. Yeah, so when the young woman protests against her boyfriend's erstwhile boyfriend's predatory behavior, in effect, love me for who I am and not because of, my body alone, she is raising a Kantian protest, okay? In other words, it's a defense of one's humanity. But this notion that we treat others basically with for their humanity and not as tools or objects for use or exploitation our own to gratify our own needs leads to certain other ethical dicta or ethical commandments or rules. And that is, we don't cheat people. We don't kill them. We don't torture them. We don't lie to them. We don't manipulate them. All of those are attacks on the humanity of the other. Okay. So there's a whole universe of ethical principles and behaviors to derive from this second instantiation of the categorical imperative. Okay. So that's the second, and we can't say enough about that. Okay. And that, in effect, is in great measure, I'm slightly exaggerating, but in great measure, that's what ethical culture has been based on. And Felix Adler went through three periods in his long leadership. The first was as a type of agnostic. And the second period, where he was trying to reinterpret ethical culture, was basically to elevate the importance. And he lectured on this often, on the importance of the moral law. And the moral law he had in mind was, almost precisely Kant's notion of the moral law. And then he gets into a more elaborate construct of the spiritual universe in his last phase. Okay, now the third instantiation of the categorical imperative is one which philosophers have given the least attention to. And it basically says, it's a little arcane. Kant says every rational being must so act as if he were, through his maxim, always a lawmaking member in the universal kingdom of ends. So by obeying the categorical imperative, the universal moral law, that we indeed join with others in what Kant calls this elegant phrase. It's a little bit cryptic. Who knows what he means? And the kingdom of ends. That is, we join with other people who, in principle, hold to the same rational dicta that we do, and so on and so forth. But not much attention has been given to this third instantiation of the CI, and I don't think we need to give much attention to it. Number two is by far, from a moral point of view, ethical point of view, is by far the most important and the most germane to ethical culture, and I'd like to believe the most germane to our own personal lives. So, for example, what's interesting about this is that if you ask Kant, what is the most important ethical value? He does not say it is love. He doesn't say it's compassion or kindness. The pinnacle of ethical values, according to Immanuel Kant, is respect. What we need to, we don't have to love others. And he would agree, contrary to Jesus, you cannot be commanded to love another. Okay. But you can be commanded, at least in a formal sense, to respect others. That means respect the humanity in a non-abusive way of the other human being. And that raises an important question. I mean, an important issue for my mind in terms of the nature of ethics. It's easy, we might say, to be ethical towards people we like and love. But ethics does its real hard work when you ask the question, how am I going to relate to people whom I do not like, whom I can't stand, whom I find disgusting? Okay. Kant would say we don't have to love them. We don't have to like them, but at a minimum, we have to respect them. Okay, we have to respect their humanity. Now, that leads to certain conclusions. It certainly has a very important place in liberal democracies in terms of how we treat people, okay, including those whom we most despise. We can take people who commit crimes and lock them up in prison, but even the prisoner retains a modicum of freedom and respect. We cannot utterly abuse the other person, even as we condition their freedom. We do not torture the torturer. We do not rape the rapist. We do not burn down the house of the arsonist. What we look for is a sort of equivalent punishment that, in some sense, in an enlightened society, recognizes nevertheless the humanity of the person whom we nevertheless are compelled to punish. Okay, do you understand? That's a Kantian. Am I being clear about this in terms of the application? I hope I am. That's a Kantian precept of the highest value, okay, in that regard. Okay, let me just say a few words. I didn't want to take over the whole thing. We'll have time for some questions. Let me just say that Felix Adler, our founder, was a student of Immanuel Kant. Although the sources of ethical culture come from many directions, but the outline of his philosophy remained broadly a Kantian route. In other words, he certainly, and this is not part of our class discussion, he certainly appropriated Kant's epistemology and so forth. Kant was the supreme idealist, which means that mind creates reality. And Felix Adler was a German idealist as well. It sounds a little bit strange. We're not going to go there. But when it came to ethics, Adler appropriates the framework of the categorical imperative, but modifies it radically. The 18th century in which Kant flourished was the century of the individual par excellence. It's the century in which we develop natural rights, which become human rights in the 20th century, and natural rights are held by individuals. Okay, it's the basis of our own constitutional government. It's individuals in the United States of America, and Jefferson recognized this very well. It's individuals who hold rights. In effect, it's the age of the individual. A problem that Adler had with Kant is that the obedience to the categorical imperative is a type of vertical relationship that the individual person has with a supervening philosophical principle. Okay. But it's a relation that the individual holds alone as an individual. Adler thought that it was too individualized. And what he did was he basically flattened the categorical imperative and broadened it so that the ethical relations that the person has is not merely with a principle, but with other people, with other human beings. He socializes the categorical imperative, okay? And out of that you have ethical culture. You could say maybe it's illuminated a little bit in Kant's dictum of the kingdom of ends, which he never develops. But indeed, Adler takes a social view of the categorical imperative and basically says that all human beings contain a type of spiritual essence. We are also connected to the family of human beings, to all others, in a web of humanity. And we are to so act as to bring out the best, that is, the essential, unique essence of the person. And when we do, we bring out the best in ourselves. That was Adler's reworking of the categorical imperative. Again, the inspiration was Kant, but he critiques Kant and he believes socializes him and takes it further and creates a communal social philosophy out of what was a highly individualistic rule that has us obeying, in effect, cosmic or ethereal commands, okay, that issue from impersonal reason. So that's it. There's a lot more I could say. What I'm trying to do is just give you a smattering, an introduction to deontological ethics. What does it mean? It means doing the right thing, okay? But doing the right thing becomes, let me just put a little bit of gloss on this, doing the right thing for the deontologist supersedes the issue of consequences. So, I've long believed every mother is in some sense a Kantian. If Sonny Boy gets in trouble in the classroom and is basically feels the impulse to lie to the teacher when caught, I don't know, sticking chewing gum in somebody's hair. Mom says, "No, Sonny, you basically don't lie to get yourself out of that. Okay, what you do is you tell the truth. Why? Because truth telling, a la categorical imperative, is required. You tell the truth, okay? And whatever punishments the chips fall where they may, whatever punishment you get, well, buck up to it. That's what you're going to have to deal with. If that, in effect, is your principle, and certainly my mother, I'm being a little stark, my mother certainly took that approach with me. It was important, Joseph, to do the right thing. You tell the truth, you don't lie, okay? And the consequences are very secondary. You don't lie to get yourself out of something, okay? Now, let me just end with this, that shows how difficult ethics are. An example that he gives to highlight and dramatize the categorical imperative, I'll end with this thought, although it's sort of a downer. He basically says, to illustrate his anti-consequentialism and his deontological stance, his obedience to the moral law. He says that if you're in your cabin and a boy comes into your, knocks on the door and said, "Mr. Kant, there is an axe murderer who's running after me. Can you hide me? Can you protect me?" And he says, "Sure, sonny, come in, get under the bed." Okay. And 20 minutes later, a 6-foot-tall guy with an axe comes to the door. You open the door and he asks you, "Excuse me, sir, did a 6-year-old boy recently come to your house? And is he in your house now?" The categorical imperative, according to Kant, says, "Yes, indeed. You cannot lie even to save a human life." Right. Now, I suspect most of us would not behave that way. Now, his rationale is, again, you can't predict the future. While you're in your cabin, the kid could have escaped through a window, unbeknownst to you, and you turn the axe murderer away, and he sees the kid running into the woods and runs after him. So you could never predict the future. The only thing we could know is the goodwill. That is, we have acted in accordance with the moral law. Okay. Again, most of us would not act that way, but I bet you most of us, some, and we'll talk about utilitarianism next week, most of us are a combination, a sort of uneven mix of utilitarians and Kantians, okay, deontologists. I think most people, I'm going to go out on a limb, most people here tonight, all 27 guests, are to some extent prevailingly, can be sympathetic to Kant's overall picture. In the sense, I bet you most of you think that it's right to tell the truth. You just don't tell the truth when it's advantageous. The truth has a certain pull on us, a certain claim. You tell the truth, you keep your promises, you repay your debts, and so on. Even if it's difficult, okay, even if you don't want to, even if it's hard, even if it might lead to negative consequences of some sort, we're biased in that direction. And only we become only utilitarians if indeed the stakes are very high. I mean, I suspect all of us, and I would hope you would lie to save the life of another human being and not become prissy, purist Kantians and tell the truth and let a child be slaughtered. I don't think we would do that. We would import a utilitarian salve, a bomb, onto our strict Kantianism in that regard. But I think we're all mixes of those two schools, and we'll talk more about that next time. So let me just end that right now. Thank you for being such a patient class tonight. Okay. Thank you. I didn't see anybody on their cell phones. That does happen with undergraduates. I get very angry in the classroom. I didn't see anybody take out your cell phones. But if there's time, anybody has any questions or thoughts, I'd love to entertain them. First of all, it's important to me as a teacher, okay, that I've been clear. Okay, not that you agree with me, not that you think this is the greatest thing since apple pie, but that in effect I've been able to communicate these ideas in ways that are accessible to you. Yes, no? I don't see a
Well,
great
we think so. We
I don't see a
think
great
so,
deal of
but we
enthusiasm.
don't want
I
the
don't see a great deal of
actual
enthusiasm. What?
test, though. I mean, we don't want to be tested on it. Well, thank you so much,
Oh,
Joe.
my
This is
pleasure.
really.
I love this stuff. I mean, this is the warp and woof, right? And I do believe in the categorical imperative, especially number two. Okay.
But we do have a question. Michaeline has a question. Michaeline from Brooklyn Society. Go ahead, Michaeline, unmute yourself.
Where are you?
Thank you.
Oh, there you are. Hello. Yes.
I'm in Brooklyn, and I'm a member of the Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture.
That's good.
Thank you. I think it's very good.
Okay.
I'd like to circle back to the Kantian principle on respect as
Yes.
being the most important value.
Yes.
I wrote next to that with question marks, Hitler,
Well,
Mussolini.
Hitler is problematic for everyone but Donald Trump. Hitler
I
is
wasn't going to
always,
say that word.
oh, Hitler is always the great spoiler. The point is, let me just be very clear about, let me get a little complex here. Kant, I'm sure, would oppose torturing our worst malefactors. Torture, I'm absolutely, I worked for Amnesty International on anti-torture campaigns. Torture is the most heinous of all human behaviors, okay? That degrades not only the victim, but also the perpetrator. It should have no place on the planet, on planet Earth, right? And Kant would agree we should not torture. But oddly enough, it's interesting. I've been a lifelong opponent, and I was helped to abolish the death penalty in New Jersey. I was the chairman of the New Jersey Coalition Against the Death Penalty. We worked for years to abolish capital punishment in our state. And we finally, after a 9-year campaign, very smartly articulated, were able to get the legislature to overturn our death penalty law. I oppose the death penalty on Kantian grounds. I think basically strapping someone, making them helpless, strapping them to a gurney and pumping them up with poisons to kill them is the ultimate expression, along with torture, of the abuse of their humanity. And on Kantian principles, I oppose it. Kant, however, was not opposed to the death penalty, and he basically defended the death penalty on his own ethical principles. Okay, he has an example in the Critique of Pure Judgment, Critique of Judgment. Excuse me. He said, if you had a cluster, a colony of Europeans who had been marooned for decades on a Pacific island, and this is a time, it was interesting, where it's a creature of the time. This is when they were exploring the South Seas for the first time, right? And he says, if there's a colony of Europeans on a South Pacific island, okay, and one of them, members of this colony, had committed a heinous murder, okay, and he says that the colony has determined that the only adequate punishment is death. They build a scaffolding to hang this guy. And as the noose is around the neck, okay, they see that there is a ship coming from Europe that will basically rescue everyone on the island, bring them back to Europe where they will scatter, so they will no longer be a coherent community. Kant says the last thing these people have to do before the ship hits shore is to open the scaffolding and hang this guy. Okay. Why? Because again, consequences don't do it. Now, how does Kant justify this? I don't. I use Kantian principles against him. I use Kantian principles to oppose the death penalty. He basically says we are rational agents, and there's a certain truth to this. He says, as rational agents, if we are a rational agent and we commit a heinous crime, as rational agents, we would will a punishment. Listen to this. We would will a punishment, okay, that we suffer a punishment that is proportionate to the infraction or crime that we have committed. And he comes to the conclusion that the only proportionate or just or only appropriate punishment for murder is death. Okay, but the rational agent would will that upon himself. I don't quite think they would, but that is the justification. Again, reason and rationality has an incredible force and power in Kant's thinking. But in some sense, he's not totally wrong. I remember about 30 years ago, there was a feature on the news of a graduate student in mathematics in California who was imprisoned for, I don't know, 25 years. He was a very smart guy, I think went to University of California at Berkeley, who murdered his dissertation advisor. Okay. And the reason he did that was he thought the dissertation advisor was giving him a very hard time, was constantly demanding that he rewrite the dissertation and so on and so forth. He felt belittled and humiliated and eventually killed his dissertation advisor. And the authorities in prison came to him and said, "We will take years off your sentence." He'd already been in prison a long time, if indeed you submit yourself to rehabilitation. And his response was in the spirit of what Immanuel Kant might reason. He said, "Screw it. Punish me if you want, but don't indeed impose your values in the form of rehabilitation on me. I did the right thing by murdering this SOB, and you're not going to correct my behavior through your values, your rehabilitation." Well, I got to tell you, I'm not sure I would argue that if I were he. But I sort of understand the reasoning. There is something a little bit humiliating and condescending about the notion of rehabilitation, right? It's imposing society's values and claiming a certain virtue and superiority for them to the value. This guy thought he was perfectly justified in murdering this SOB who gave him a hard time over his doctoral dissertation, right? I'm raising a point here. I'm trying to show, pull out, in effect, what are glimmers of Kantian reason and sensibility. It's not all that strange, but in effect, getting back to Hitler, I think Kant would argue that the death penalty would be highly. I don't. I'm opposed to the death penalty. Here I'm a Kantian, in reverse. I'm absolutely opposed to the death penalty in all cases. Okay, but Kant would oppose torture for Adolf Hitler. He would not oppose the death penalty, and so on and so forth. So there you are. But in withholding maximal aggression against the malefactor who has harmed us by saying we will not harm the person as they have harmed us. In that sense, we're leaving space for the, I would say, the virtue of respect. Do you know what I'm saying? To that degree, and it may be just 2 inches wide, we are respecting the humanity of the person. We're not reducing them to an animal brought to slaughter. Okay? That's the difference. Okay.
And yet
I
he
don't know.
did. He did bring humans to slaughter.
Oh, there's no
So,
doubt about it.
yeah,
Nobody, I'm not saying, no. The
go
question
ahead.
isn't what he does. The question is what we would do, right? How we would behave. I think that's your question. And so forth. That's not to just right. None of that. Look, you may not believe in the death penalty, but that doesn't mean I don't believe in punishment. Okay. And so forth and so on. But these, I think these factors factor into questions of jurisprudence and law. Okay. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Michaeline. Well, thank you, everybody. This is
That's it.
it's great. I guess that's it. You were so clear, and you were afraid
Well,
no one would say
I'm not
it, but
convinced.
everyone. All right.
I have one question.
Yeah, let's get one more question. I want to go to bed happy tonight.
So I and
Yeah.
it's and I'm hearkening back to my introductory philosophy class and the continental philosophers when I was an undergrad. I seem to remember something about Kant relying on a feeling of right and wrong, the prick of conscience,
Yes.
and a feeling that
Right.
when asked, what is at the basis of our morality, it's
Right.
that we how can we know that there is morality at all? And he said, because we feel it. Is that consistent? Because it wasn't satisfying then,
No.
and
No,
maybe that didn't.
I don't think it is. I think he would argue that there are feelings associated with moral behaviors, but if indeed we attempt to act ethically or morally on the basis of our feelings, then the act in effect is not itself moral. He's a rationalist and he believes in reason, and he believes that we have to be obedient to reason. Okay, if we're being obedient to our sentiments, we are not strictly we the sentiments may align with our reason, but if we're acting from our sentiments rather than acting from our reason, we are strictly speaking not acting ethically. Again, we could be acting prudentially. He's not saying you're doing the wrong thing here. He's just saying it's not strictly speaking an ethical act, it's a prudential act. Okay.
It didn't seem satisfying then, and it
Right.
and yeah, thank you
It's a
very.
yes, it's a tough, again, I think because Kant is such an absolutist, I think it becomes impossible for people of goodwill to accept him whole. But what is important about Kant is that he's introducing, and I do believe this, an insight into the nature of morality that's worthy of our consideration. In other words, if we behave in ways, if we strive to be virtuous and ethical, but we do it because our motive is merely personal gratification, maybe in the crudest sense, we'll get richer, you know, our reputations will be enhanced. Then you ask, as I said before, you ask the question, what is ethical about that behavior? So, it becomes part of a cost-benefit analysis. I mean, the capitalist, Donald Trump understands that very well. I mean, it's nothing but transactions. If that's what your notion of ethics is, then it's not ethical.
Does Kant leave room for altruism and the satisfaction that comes from?
Yes, yes, yes. Okay. He does in the prologue, he does mention that it is ethical to express a genuine, a broad beneficence towards other human beings. Yes, that's part of, yes.
But he doesn't fault us for getting an emotional or satisfaction from doing something.
No, not at all. He recognizes that we're emotional creatures. The question is, how does our ethics originate? And that source of origination determines whether a behavior is strictly ethical or something else. Okay, but certainly we can experience.
What I'm asking is, because there is a certain amount of utility in altruism.
Yes.
For us as individuals, is that a factor in the equation?
No, again, if the motive is to be altruistic, then it's not an ethical act.
Okay, great.
If the effect may be altruistic, there's no problem with that. But if our motivation, in fact, he goes as far as to say that if indeed we are motivated to do the right thing, and that's what deontology is about, doing the right thing. If we're motivated to do the right thing because it makes us feel better about ourselves. If that's the motive, I want to feel good by being kind to you or, you know, bringing you cookies and donuts when you're not feeling well, then in effect, that's strictly not an ethical feel. In other words, if the purpose is to feel good about ourselves for doing it, strictly speaking, that's not ethical. He said we may indeed feel good about it, but if we're motivated to do it because we want to feel good about our own virtue, and, you know, the critique of virtue flaunting sort of gets at this in some ways. You know, if you hear people who, you know, sound off in such a way as espousing their virtue, Kant would have a lot of trouble with that, right? I mean, what's virtuous if indeed you're doing this to feel better about yourself, right? He would do that. So in effect, he believed, and this gets really Prussian, that to behave, he recognized that to be able to act ethically in obedience to the moral law, to some degree, we are suppressing our happiness, okay? That there is a conflict between being moral and being happy, okay? Now that's a hard pill to swallow, but you know, our own founder, Felix Adler said, who was a Kantian, and boy, he was as Prussian as I think as Kant was, he said, we dare not make happiness the end of life. The end of life is not happiness, it's worthiness. Which is very Kantian. We are to make ourselves worthy. That is, we are to respect the humanity of others. But if you make happiness the end of life, you've missed the point. That's not what life is about. But think about it. If indeed you live to make yourself worthy, you're not going to be the happiest guy on the block. You know, I have a little trouble with that. I want a little bit more. I'm sorry, Felix. You know, I find that's a little bit too austere. In other words, in Kant and in Adler, they're both German idealists, right? Both very Prussian, right? There's a type of outlook in that. That's not me, you know? I don't think Kant went around singing and dancing very much, you know?
All right, we have a couple more minutes and we have two questions.
Okay, so let's go. And then
Barbara Byrne. Yeah. Barbara, you are unmuted. Go ahead.
Well, I have a question for you, Joe. What about the way we're schooled? In other words, what we learn in school, because they find that the people in Gaza are taught to hate Jews and they're taught to, you know, kill anybody who lives on their land that's not a Muslim, blah, blah, blah. And that makes them do very horrible things. It's pounded into their heads since they're babies. And so do you think that has something to do with it, the way we're schooled and the way we're trained by our environment?
Oh, it's sure. Whence legitimate rules.
Yeah, well, of course. Yes, I think how people are socialized when they're younger and how they're trained and educated has a great deal to do with the way in which they morally behave when they get older, right? I agree. A lot of behaviors these days are just absolutely despicable. Sure, right. they need a little bit of a Kantian pill in the morning, I think. Yeah, thank you. Any other? There was one last question.
Yeah, Michael Bacanas. Michael, unmute yourself and ask a question.
Okay, there we go. I'm unmuted. So, Joe, I'm interested in how you fit punishment. You said you were not in favor of capital punishment, right, but in favor of punishment in general. How does that fit into this categorical imperative framework?
Well, I think it does. As I mentioned, I gave you an example of Kant's reasoning. I don't know. I mean, let me just say, and this is not Kant, one could argue, okay, and I think there's some compelling character to this argument. One could argue that by, in effect, being citizens in the state, in the community, we all pledge ourselves to abide by the rules that allow us to live a cooperative life, right? We obey the laws and so on. And in the process of doing that, we're all expected to give something up. In other words, there are many times when I want to speed on the highway, but I don't. I may be inclined to indulge my impulses, but I restrain them because it's wrong to basically be indulgent in that way. In order to live, I mean, Freud wrote this, civilization is discontents. In order to have civilization, we have to suppress our aggressions, our instincts, our sensate behaviors, our appetites, our desires, and our wills. We all give something up in order to cooperate and be citizens. The criminal, the lawbreaker, basically says, I will not play by your rules. I will play by my own rules, and I will do as I damn please. I will rob your bank. I will, you know, hack your computer. I will do whatever it is. I will mug you on the street. I will not restrain myself and play by the rules which you have done. So in a certain sense, we could argue from a rational point of view that when it comes to the rule breaker, they have taken liberties which we have restrained ourselves from taking. And therefore, we are justified as a society to get something back from them. Okay, that's an argument for punishment, for what you'd call retributive justice, okay, which is the justifiable argument for punishment, that they need to pay us back. We've given up something that they refuse to have given up, and they've taken what they wanted. That's unfair. And they need, in effect, to pay us back. And that becomes a justification for some form of punishment. And I'm not totally unsympathetic to that. I mean, I think that has a certain compelling nature. Now, the question, what's critical to me, and the United States fails extremely badly, is can we, in effect, impose redemptive, justifiable forms of punishment that we're not very good at. In fact, we're absolutely despicably awful at doing that. Prisons, I don't know how many people have walked into maximum security prisons. It's not the type of place you want to spend 10 minutes. You know, I mean, we do a horrible job. I mean, prisons are become warehouses for the mentally ill. The violence is unbelievable in prisons. It's where, it's the site. If we're wondering, what, concerned about torture, don't look to Abu Ghraib or Guantanamo, look to American prisons. That is the major site of torture in America. So, you know, it's the nature of the punishment rather than punishment itself that I think is, the, from my point of view, which I think is the critical issue. So I don't know if that answers the question, but the categorical imperative certainly allows that, as I've pointed out. The notion that, Kant would claim again, that the malefactor, the lawbreaker, the one who violates the categorical imperative and violates us, would will, as a rational agent, will that he suffer the consequences proportionate to the violations that he's taken, right? And so on and so forth. Very few prisoners would say that, but some might. It's a principle. It's a theoretical principle. It's a moral. That's what ethical philosophers do. They come up with ethical principles and so forth. Okay?
Well, okay. Thank you, Joe. And thank you, everybody. Wonderful to be with you here at the New York Society for Ethical Culture.
Come back
be
next
sure
week.
To check the website and see all the programs that are listed on our events calendar. You're welcome to attend those that are on Zoom. And of course, this series continues next week with our second installment, Utilitarianism, and you would do well to come. So,
right. You don't get much out of it unless you show up in class. That's what I tell my students, right? Right. I also tell them to bring their books with them. You know, I'd say to my students, they'd come, sometimes the students would sit, mostly at Hunter, not Columbia, they'd sit in the classroom with nothing on their desk. They look so naked there. And I'd say, look, if you're not interested in this, I understand, but at least look like a student. You know, if you're going to be a student, just look like one, which means you carry a book with you, right? And you
That's
put it on
we'll
the desk.
That's what we'll do next time. Right? We'll have a book on a desk
right.
And
right.
Look studious. We'll look studious. Right. Just don't give us
okay,
more.
Friends. So good
Thank
being
you,
with
Jeff.
You. Yeah, have
Goodbye.
A good
Thank
everyone.
You.
Okay, bye-bye.